Okay, so you started a group called Roll Like a Girl. Mm-hmm. Do you have the Estelle Saw shirt? You got a shirt on there? Hey. So why don't you tell us a little bit about that?
So in 2019, I almost said 2019, it was like October timeframe. So I had been working with other groups trying to get women to the community. I'm the highest ranking in my area. I have been for a while. To get anyone higher, you have to go to St. Louis, Arkansas, Kansas, or Tulsa. Okay. Like, and those are all 2-3-4 hour drives for me. Myself and one other girl were the higher ranking, and we were trying to build the community for women. The problem was, is nobody was willing to come in and do seminars because it was so small. And I could almost guarantee you each time I could guarantee at least 30 women to be on the mat for that, for a seminar. I couldn't get it to happen. And I got so frustrated and tired because I was driving 2 hours here, 3 hours there, 4 hours there to go assist with these seminars.
Yeah.
And so I was getting worn out and I was investing my time, my energy. And some of these seminars, I was bringing 20 plus girls with me. Mm. I mean, like a convoy down the highway for 2-3 hours. And so I remember telling my husband, and I was complaining on, it was a Wednesday night because we had gotten back from Nogi that day. And I was like, I'm so tired of not being able to have that. Like, mm-hmm. And he's like, if you're tired, do something about it. Mm-hmm. And I was like, what am I supposed to do? He goes, do it yourself. And so I guarantee you not. I stayed up all night that night thinking, like, if I did it, what would I name it? Mm-hmm. If I did it, like, how would I do this? Like, what would be, like, what would my lead person be? What would, like, you know what I mean? Like, just brainstorming. And I woke up the next morning and I told my husband, like, I'm going to call it Roll Like a Girl. And he goes, why? I said, because if you ask any of my women, since I've been teaching them, when I started jiu-jitsu, I was the only female on the mat. Mm-hmm. When me and my husband took over the gym, I was the only female on the mat. I had to learn how to roll with my body. I had to learn not to roll like a man because I was getting hurt by doing it. I faced more injuries trying to keep up with the men at their pace on their level mm-hmm. than I did when I started doing it my own way. When I started breaking down my body type, mm-hmm. and how my weight shifts and where my pressure goes and where my knee needs to be versus where, like, my male instructor, mm-hmm. who was at the time my black belt, was 245 pounds, 6'3", this big old Goliath guy, and here I am, like, little tiny David, like, we're gonna roll, let's hope I don't break today. I had to develop my own style, and mm-hmm. so for years I've been telling girls, quit rolling like a man, roll like a girl, use your hips. Use what God blessed you with.
Yep.
Girl, you have a booty. Use your base. And so I decided, since that was always my catchphrase, that that's what it was going to be called. Mm-hmm. With Roll Like a Girl. I was tired of men. When I first started, it was hard to get a training partner to train with me because I was the female. Not just that, but I was the coach's wife.
Yeah.
Like, so my husband kind of made this thing for almost a year where in order to roll with him, you had to roll with me, mm-hmm. which then made the guys realize, like, don't treat me like a fragile girl, mm-hmm. because the minute that you hold back, I'm going to take advantage of it. Mm-hmm. And so I forced them to respect me because I forced them to understand, like, you have to keep up with me. I'm not going to hold back because you are.
Let me interject something here, because I hear this argument a lot. We are not forcing dudes to roll with us because of personal or religious beliefs. It has nothing to do with that. I believe all of us are respectful of that. There's a difference between just simply not wanting to roll with someone because they're female. You somehow, like, you look down upon them. At the end of the day, you don't have to roll with anyone. But like she said, her husband didn't have to roll with them either. So, like, it's a mutual respect thing, because there's definitely been people who I know who, like, on a just their own personal level, they don't roll with women. I'm like, bro, I'm not trying to get between you and your stuff.
100%. I don't force anybody to roll. In our gym, we do what's called a dance card. Have your dance card full. If male or female, if you don't feel comfortable rolling with somebody, just be like, hey, sorry, I'm going to roll with this person over here next. Like, keep your dance card full. That's never something I'm going to force on people. Mm-hmm. But my husband put it out there because I was the female coach. Mm-hmm. I was the only female coach in the area. So if my own students won't roll with me, then nobody else is going to either.
Yeah.
And how am I supposed to develop as a practitioner and as a teacher if my students don't trust me as an instructor?
Yep.
And so I got tired of people telling me I couldn't be competitive because I'm a mom, because I have PTSD, because I have this, because I have that, because I'm broken, because I'm this. And like, I had an urge to just prove myself, not to everybody else, but to myself. Mm-hmm. And so I started this by myself. In my first seminar, I had 38 women show up. Right? 38 women. And what I did is, as I created this and put it out there, so that Wednesday night, I thought of it. Thursday morning, I woke up, I messaged my tattoo artist, who's my purple belt. And I was like, hey, I need you to make me a patch. This is what I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. My grandmother was a riveter. So of course, I'm going to pay tribute to my roots, which is Rosie the Riveter. Who else gives off that strong woman empowerment vibe? Like, when you think back, it's Rosie. And so he switched it up and he put her in a gi, put her in a purple belt. Like, he made it happen and created this very old, like, old-fashioned American style tattoo, and that's my patch. And so that Friday, I traveled up to Branson because I wanted it not to be at my gym, because my gym's kind of in the middle of nowhere. Mm-hmm. So I put it in Branson, in the middle of 2 hours from Tulsa, 2 hours from Arkansas, 2 hours from my area, less than 2 hours. So it was the meeting point. That seminar was set that Monday. I did it. That was in October. I did my seminar the weekend of my birthday. Hey. Now, granted, I was suffering from tremors throughout my entire seminar, trying to control it, talking, and I didn't care. Like, I had to show these women that, like, you can have a fire and a competitive side that you can hone in, you can access. Don't let anybody take away your drive and your power because of the gender you are. It shouldn't matter. Like, so I can tell you that 80% of the women that showed up were mothers. We're mothers, and we had white belt, and I was the highest ranking at that point, which was a purple belt. And we had four different states show up.
Awesome.
I had Kansas, Oklahoma, Arkansas, Missouri. And it was a huge deal for this area. Now, at this point, Roll Like a Girl has become a lot bigger than what I ever thought it would be. Like,
always does that.
It's like, I'm blessed because I have this community of women who, like, I say, hey, I'm doing a seminar. They're going to show up. Now I've added women on since then to help me because, well, you can't do everything by yourself. So I have Erica Vatt, who is my right-hand man. She was at the seminar with me, or at the camp with me.
Okay.
She was the one with the, like, tattoos down the leg.
I got you.
So, yeah. So she has been my right-hand man. She keeps my brain focused. She keeps me on point. And then next was Shauna Dupree. She joined me to help me with the social media aspect and kind of get the word around. And then my daughter, Kieran, stepped in about a year ago. And she runs the Facebook page. And then we have Miranda Bennett, who stepped in to run the Instagram page. Now, we all kind of still dabble in everything. But I have this strong group of women who assist me and travel with me. And we've done five or six seminars. The last one was in Jefferson City. So we're kind of branching out of Missouri now. And it's been a blessing. But my biggest thing when I do these seminars is I tell women, like, this isn't me. This isn't mine. This is for us. Like, this is ours. This is for women. This isn't solely about me. This isn't Alexandra Loudermill's, like, seminar. Mm-hmm. That's not who I am. Like, I want women to realize that they can be competitive, because of course, like, you and I aren't going to get any competitors big more than what we have right now.
Yeah.
But the white belt women will, and the blue belt women will. And we're building that competition mindset in women who never thought they could compete.
Exactly.
And that's what we need to get